Good evening. This is the CBS Evening News. Dan Rather reporting.
On Saturday, the 4th of October, 1986, at around 10:43 p.m., 54-year-old TV anchorman Dan Rather was walking home on the Upper East Side of Manhattan after finishing a dinner with an associate at 1095 Park Avenue on 89th Street. It wasn't long after leaving when two men in their 30s started following Rather down the street and eventually began accosting him, with one of them repeating the phrase, "Kenneth, what is the frequency?" Rather explained to the two that they had the wrong man, and that he had no idea what they were talking about, which only elevated their aggressive pursuit. Upon reaching 88th Street, one of the men punched Rather in the jaw, just under the left ear, knocking him to the pavement. Rather quickly got up and fled into the nearby lobby of 1075 Park Avenue, where the attackers pursued and continued their assault, shouting the same phrase over and over whilst punching and kicking him. Both the doorman and superintendent of the building witnessed the attack, with the latter intervening and coming to Rava's aid as the assailants fled the scene. Rava suffered multiple bruises on his back and a swelling of the jaw, but neither of the two attackers robbed him of any possessions, despite him having a reasonable amount of money on him at the time. Rather was taken to Lenox Hill Hospital and assessed, but soon discharged with only minor injuries. He told police and detectives that one of the men who attacked him was 6 foot tall, had dark hair and a moustache, and both were well dressed, wearing a dark suit, white shirt and black tie. It wasn't clear whether or not the attack was intentional or a case of mistaken identity, due to the fact that the name Kenneth was directed at Rather throughout the ordeal. A few days later, on Monday the 6th of October, Dan Rather was back on his usual slot on CBS, hosting the evening news. In his closing statement, Rather addressed the attack on national television, after news had spread about the bizarre incident in newspapers.
In closing tonight, a personal note if I may, over the weekend, as some of you may have already heard or read, I was assaulted with violence on a Manhattan street. Why and exactly by whom remains unclear, and it may never be determined. Perhaps it was just another one of those bizarre and frightening incidents that seem to happen from time to time in our country and elsewhere. I do know that I was luckier than many other Americans who've been victims of violent crime, and for that I'm very thankful. Aside from a little stiffness and some bumps and bruises, I'm feeling fine. I just want to thank those who came to my aid and all of you who have written or called to express your concern. We'll see you here again tomorrow night. Good night.
Papers ran the story during the early days of the incident, but the case soon faded into obscurity when no further progress was made into who was responsible. The mysterious phrase, however, did anything but disappear. In the following years, the line, "What's the frequency, Kenneth?" which oddly is a mistranslation of the original quote itself, became somewhat of a pop culture reference in other forms of media. In 1987, the year after the attack, California-based band Game Theory released their album Lolita Nation, with the opening 46-second track being titled, "Kenneth, What's the Frequency?" inspired by the strange events of Rava's attack. A few years later, in 1993, Daniel Clowes released the otherworldly graphic novel, Like a Velvet Glove Cast in Iron, where the phrase is used as part of a subplot involving a conspiracy theorist. In the story, a character called Billings aggressively asks the protagonist, "What's the frequency, Kenneth?" believing that a mythical, godlike creature known as Mr. Jones exists, and can only be contacted by achieving a specific mental frequency. Much like the incident with Dan Rather, the protagonist's name in the comic is also not Kenneth. More famously, the American rock band REM released the album Monster in 1994, which included the hit single What's the Frequency, Kenneth? The single, which reached number 21 in the top 40 charts, was inspired by Rather's now infamous incident, with the band's lead singer, Michael Stipe, explaining. It was the premier unsolved American surrealist act of the 20th century. It's a misunderstanding that was scarily random, media hyped, and just plain bizarre. A year after its release, REM performed the song live on The Late Show with David Letterman, and was joined by none other than Dan Rather himself, albeit a slightly out of tune and out of rhythm one. The now infamous Kenneth case looked as though it were going to remain firmly archived in the Library of Crimes, lost to time in the corridors of forgotten media. But what nobody knew at the time is that one of the Kenneth duo had already struck again, and this time he had become a killer. On Wednesday the 31st of August 1994, at around 5 p.m, almost a month before REM were to release their new album, a man approached the Rockefeller Center in Manhattan, where the Today Show studios are situated. Armed with a rifle hidden inside the sleeve of a smock coat, the man tried to storm into the studio, only to be stopped by an NBC stagehand, 33-year-old Campbell Montgomery, who noticed the firearm. The man quickly left in his car before returning around 20 minutes later. Montgomery was standing at the building's entrance when he noticed the man return, so tried to alert the police. The gunman then took a military stance and fatally shot Montgomery in the back. The man was quickly apprehended and arrested, and was identified as being 46-year-old William Tager from North Carolina. When interviewed by the police, Tager claimed that NBC had been beaming transmissions into his brain for years, watching him and sending him signals, and that the attack he had planned on the studio himself was to stop the transmissions once and for all. He was paranoid to the point that he drove a rented car to the studios, as he thought the network had bugged his own, and claimed to have no history of drugs or alcohol abuse. Likely due to having mental capacity issues, Tager was found guilty of manslaughter rather than murder, and received a 12.5 to 25 year prison sentence at Sing Sing Correctional Facility. It's during his time behind bars that the story gets even weirder, as Tager opened up to prison staff about his supposed intentions. During an interview in January 1997, he told prison psychiatrists that he was a time traveller from the year 2265, and that he was already a convicted felon in his timeline, who was sent on a highly experimental mission back in time in exchange for his freedom. He also claimed that the future authorities were tracking his movements via a chip implanted in his brain, so they knew where he was in the past. It's at this point that Tager then admitted to being one of the two men who attacked Dan Rather over 10 years prior, and explained that the reason for the attack was because he looked like his timeline's vice president, known as Kenneth Burrows. Dan Rather was shown pictures of Tager and confirmed that he was one of the attackers in his case, claiming, "There is no doubt in my mind that this is the person." Both Tager and Rather gave identical recollections and details of the building where the attack took place, which wasn't public knowledge, leaving authorities with no doubt that the story was true. The second assailant in the attack on Rather, however, has never been identified and remains a mystery to this day. So, case closed, right? Well, actually, no. There is another theory as to why Tager actually committed the attack on Dan Rather, which makes a lot more sense, and it's somewhat interesting that Tager never mentioned this himself as being the truth behind his actions. Around the time of the initial attack on Dan Rather, a former music publicist turned inventor called Kenneth Schaefer had figured out a way to hijack Russian television broadcasts using US satellite receivers, so that Americans could watch content from Soviet networks. During the peak of Cold War tensions between the two states, little was known about television behind the Iron Curtain, and so this gave people in the West an opportunity to view Soviet television, such as soap operas, cartoons, and cooking programs. Schaefer had these intercepted broadcasts available to view at Columbia University in New York, which drew a number of visitors who had an interest in learning about the Soviet Union. One of these visitors just so happened to be Dan Rava, who viewed the project at Columbia University on the same day that he was attacked. Ken Schaefer believes that he himself was more than likely the Kenneth that Tager was after that night, and that Dan Rava was perhaps mistaken for him after being spotted leaving the campus. Schaefer admitted that there were always people questioning him about how the interception technology worked, but he would never reveal what the frequencies were publicly. Is it possible then that Tager had more ulterior motives than he is letting on as to why he wanted to know the frequencies for Schaefer's technology? Since it was during the height of political tension between the USSR and the USA, could it be possible that Tager was working for the Russian government, sent to find out the frequencies used for intercepting Soviet broadcasting in order to attempt to shut it down? Was Tager's schizophrenia and paranoia just a cover-up for his true intentions? Probably not, but it's an interesting theory nonetheless. On the 27th of October 2010, at the age of 63, William Tager was released from prison on parole after earning a limited time credit allowance. It states on his certificate of release that, amongst other things, he must submit to regular substance abuse testing and anti-violence counselling, mustn't consume alcohol, and is prohibited from driving. So there you have it. The story of how a random attack on an anchorman birthed an alternative rock record and eventually led to a murder over a decade later. There is only one question to this story, however, that remains unanswered to this day. What was the frequency, Kenneth? Thanks for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, leave a like and comment below what you think on this case. And if you're new here, please hit the subscribe button if you're interested in more content like this. Thanks again to my patrons for supporting the channel. And thank you again for watching. See you in the next one.